Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Beach Soccer and Beach Soccer Talks number two. I'm very excited about getting in touch with everybody again, and I want to introduce my panel for today. First of all, doesn't need an introduction, but we'll talk later about my best friend in the Beach World Technical Study Group, Ramiro. He'll be joining us. Also, Angelo, the head coach of the Swiss national team. He will giving us his insight. Hello, Angelo. Welcome and thank you. And then Emiliano, the head coach of the star-studded Italian national team, will be having plenty of time to talk about the Italian national team. Welcome, Emiliano.
Ciao, ciao a tutti. Ciao, Ross.
Just for some simplicity, we're going to be speaking English. We've already spent some time talking to Emiliano, and he understands the questions, but I'll try and translate later for our non-English speaking Italian people. And I think we're going to have a great show tonight. The topic tonight is the past, the future, the present, not in that order. When we talk about the past, and we will be introducing each of our commentators and bringing their experiences, what has happened to make them the coaches that they are today. And I just want to set some parameters. Some of the statistics that you'll be seeing are from the knockout phase, and some are for the tournament's complete goals scored in all aspects. I want to also say a special thank you to Beach Soccer Worldwide and their staff, because this is a long overdue use of the media and the coaching experiences, and this is an ongoing. I'll try and remind us everybody again at the end of the production, but there will be a Beach Soccer Talk next week, and can't wait for the topic on that one. But I also want to let everybody know that we're all big boys. We can handle a little bit of criticism. We can discuss the topics. We can be open to growing. We can be open to helping our sport grow. And that is so important. Statistics cause many people fear, and fear is what stops us from going forward. So when we produce these statistics that over the past seven World Cups have been tabulated, statistics help us make the past into the present, which leads us to thinking about the future and how we will prepare our countries, our teams, our club teams, and we will develop the sport in the future. It's so important that we remember our past. And I want to start off just briefly. I remember the very first time we had a coaches symposium in Zurich, and I spoke to Angelo. And one of the things that fascinated me about Angelo and his ability to coach was that he was open to listen, open to teach, open to change. And I just want Angelo to start us off briefly about what you did in the train station with developing and producing future stars in Switzerland. Angelo?
Hello, Ross. Thank you very much.
Yeah, hi, buddy.
Yes, it was an amazing time. I think we started in 2006 to organize the event in the Zurich main station. And we had one big objective to do this. We wanted to show beach soccer to a big public. And we reached the big public because the Zurich main station, 1 million of people crossing every day this main station. So we had at least 1 million views per day. And we had a chance to invite Brazil 3-4 times. We had a chance to invite Italy. We had also the chance to invite Germany to the main station. And of course, we had also the league there. We made tournaments for kids. And a big public had a chance to see beach soccer and to play in the main station.
Thank you, Angelo. That's so excellent, because for me, what's so impressive about you is you never stop teaching and coaching and using opportunities to develop beach soccer. So Beach Soccer World, everybody thanks you and continue the hard work.
Thank you.
Ramiro, we go back a long time. And I want to bring back a topic that maybe you remember, maybe you don't. Ramiro, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay. So we were doing a coaching course in Ravenna, in Italy. And it was a long day. We had just finished. And we were walking across the field. and there was a group of maybe 30 or 40 little children, and they were screaming your name. Ramiro, Amarelli, do a bicycle kick. Please do la rovesciata, do la chilena, do it, do it. And you were calmly walking. And miraculously, there was a ball 12 meters from the goal sitting on the ground, on the beach. You quickly flicked it up, did a bicycle, the ball went in the top corner. What gives you the confidence to attempt the most difficult shot in beach soccer at any time of the day?
I think, as you comment before with Angelo, we learn from the best. Beach soccer born in Brazil a lot of years ago, about 19s. And I remember when I began to play about 1996, 1997. My first time I went to the beach, I was not able to watch videos from nobody. Nobody in Europe played beach soccer at that moment. And then when we were lucky because we went to South America, to Brazil, the ends of the 19s, and we have the luckily to play against Brazilians. And you see what they do, and it's incredible. Any simple skill, any simple technical action was amazing. How they move their body and how were they able to run the beach, how were they able to flick the ball up and make a pass. And they make passes with everything. It was amazing. Then that years I learned a lot. I film all any simple moment I can, and I copy from all of them. I remember all of them. The first one obviously was Junior, because the oldest, and he was the king and always an inspiration for me. And after him, all the youngers that after become the best in the world, like Jorginho was amazing. Angelo know him also. Also Emiliano, Benjamin was amazing. The Brazilians was incredible. And you learn from any single moment, any simple moment, you can learn from them. Then after that, you begin to think that you can play this sport. Then I begin to go to the beach. I begin to try all skills I see from anyone. After that, I begin to play against Major also. And then I try to copy him. Any single actions they can do, I repeat a lot of times. Angelo did also. Then, and we learn like that. We learn practicing. Then the confidence comes to you when you really control the technical actions. A lot of process, a lot of pedagogic, a lot of methodologic, but most important is to practice. If you do it a lot of times, you will be able to do it. I do it hundreds and hundreds of times.
So my question to Emiliano, he has the privilege of working with Zurlo and Gori, two of the premier strikers in the world at doing la rovesciata. Emiliano, tell me what your joy must be every day training with these types of players.
Okay, translate.
Oh. Okay. Mi puoi dire un po' che gioia ti porta a fare le pratiche con giocatori come Zurlo e Gori ogni giorno che possono fare la rovesciata senza... è proprio troppo facile per loro.
Ma diciamo che... sono due calciatori che hanno caratteristiche diverse. Gori ha una capacità acrobatica unica, penso per controllo della palla, orientamento della palla e capacità di appunto effettuare la rovesciata, penso che sia il migliore al mondo. Emanuele è più un giocatore che di rapina, è un giocatore che è molto rapido. Anche lui però è migliorato tanto in questi anni nella capacità acrobatica, come abbiamo visto nell'ultimo mondiale. Diciamo che ho due attaccanti molto importanti e che sono cresciuti tantissimo in questi ultimi anni, hanno avuto una crescita esponenziale e noi cerchiamo di metterli in condizioni di sfruttare al meglio le proprie potenzialità.
Okay, thank you so much. Basically, what he's saying is they try and put their two strikers in situations that they can utilize their God-given talent of bicycle kicks and the chilena, and they are extremely talented, but like Amarelli said, you gain the confidence from repetition. Statistics are repetitions. They are the future based on what has happened in the past. and we continue to work on them. So my next question right now is for Angelo. Can you please go over the past 15 years, what changes in the game have you noticed that are the most magnified?
This is interesting. I was today thinking about this, honestly, and I think the game changed tactically a lot. So we have at the moment, the goalkeeper was already previous, had an important situation, but now the goalkeeper starts to play, and most of the teams, they play with the goalkeeper like a fifth player. This is one tactical thing. But I think also physically, the players improved a lot. And of course, the experience of the players grew, you know. So we have a lot of players who don't start with 45 or with 40 or with 35. We have a lot of players who started with 11, 12 years, like know a lot. And also the Spanish team, like Elio, also we have so many, like Lorenz, we have so many players, they play, they started with grassroots already, you know. This is one thing. And of course, we have to be, it's dangerous to say that all the tactics changed, because we have the most important teams like Portugal and Brazil. They still don't play as much as all of the teams with the goalkeeper. They still play with the wings that try to win 1-1 in a very dynamic movements.
Okay, and Emiliano, I'd like to ask you, in the past 15 years, if we have a look at your team roster, looking at the team roster over the last 15 years, how much has that changed? And how do you see the development of the sport through the Italian national team?
Okay, allora, diciamo che in questi anni questa disciplina si è evoluta. Se pensiamo a 15 anni fa, c'era in campo c'era meno organizzazione, diciamo che c'era molto più individualità. Calciatori che avevano grande individualità facevano la differenza. Oggi questo è molto più difficile, perché c'è stata un'evoluzione del gioco e c'è stata anche un'evoluzione della tattica. E quindi attraverso appunto la tattica cerchiamo di limitare le giocate dei calciatori che hanno più qualità, piuttosto che evidenziare le loro qualità attraverso il gioco. Nei 15 anni passati, a parte il Brasile, che giocava un beach soccer a parte, le altre squadre principalmente giocavano con un modulo 1-3-1. Oggi, specialmente in Europa, c'è stata un'evoluzione e molte nazionali utilizzano il modulo 1-2-2. Quindi questa è già stata un'evoluzione. Questa evoluzione è stata portata, secondo me, in Europa dalla Russia. Prima di questo, prima dell'avvento della Russia di Leonov, di Shaigov, eccetera, eccetera, questo modulo non era molto utilizzato in Europa. Almeno quello che ricordo io.
Ok, thank you so much.
O perlomeno, diciamo, era utilizzato solamente da qualche squadra. Prima di questo avvento, quasi tutte le nazionali giocavano 1-3-1.
Okay, thank you very much, Emiliano. Ramiro, I'd like to go to you now, and just could you tell me which countries in the last 15 years most impress you on the development aspect of the game?
Well, probably, I think, first step for us, for all European teams and for the rest of the world, was the surprise of Russia, because it's a country like Swiss with Angelo, winter countries, and they have no beaches usually, but they won world champions. They won the champion, the FIFA championship. Then they show us how they can build a process on their national team. And they was the first team who surprised the rest of the world. After that, he's here. I don't want to talk him a lot, but Angelo, for me, did a great and amazing job with Tahiti. That was a really change in the minds of the players and of the coaches and on beach soccer world. He's also his philosophy, his mentality about attack, about offensive positions, about bicycle kicks. He transferred that mentality on the minds of the Tahitians, and they made an amazing several years of high-level competition. Right now, they are not right on feet. Yes, okay, but it changed. The mentality changed a lot with them. And after that, yeah. I think Iran helped us a lot also, because they come from Asia, and they show us the level, the fight, the spirit, the competitive spirit, and also the level of the national championship they have. Show the rest of the world that with a good plan development, with a good grassroots job, they can buy a good team. And on the last years, for me, it's important also, and it's very clear, the Portugal experience. Obviously, the teams and Andrade, the Brazilian support, Brazilian Portuguese support, give them a lot. But they were able to change the system a little bit. They play different. They have the quality and the capacity to play around the sand, not on the air, not always. And then for me, they are giving us another view of the sport, another view of attack, of control the game, and other chances. Then this is the teams that, from my opinion, represent everything. Obviously, Europe, Russia, and now Italy help also Spain, Swiss, and other teams like Belarus right now, Ukraine before. We have a lot of countries that are developing a lot. But the most successful for me was Russia, Tahiti, Iran, and now Portugal for sure.
Okay, thank you. If we can go to the future, the present, and we look at the present, taking the information that the coaches have just given us, I agree 100% that Iran is one of the countries that have changed this sport. If you look at Russia, how they play 4-4, they substitute every 90 seconds, and they have the depth. And when I look at Italy, the results, final, fourth place in 2017, fourth place, 2015, fourth place, runner up in 2020. They're ranked third in the world. If we look at statistically, Iran is ranked fifth in the world, and Russia, two times world champion. When you look at the statistics, those three teams could change, in my opinion, six players and still be some of the top teams in the world because of their developmental of their players. The next point, when we look at the slide, the statistics that were obtained in the last World Cup, Romero, we spent many, many hours looking at these statistics. And I guess there's a saying, if you don't know, you just don't know. But we know how much time it takes to collect data. We know how much time it takes to create a video. I know when Angelo worked with FIFA and they made, with yourself, you guys made that video on teaching the world skills. A 1 hour video takes hundreds of hours of work preparing. We can't even talk about that because if someone doesn't know, they just don't know. But when we look at these statistics, is there something that stands out for you, Ramiro?
It's obviously, let me check and put it bigger. It's obviously, we can tell that a lot of goals and high average of goals coming from set pieces. Each team have to analyze if they invest the right time on set pieces or not, or how they invest the training time in what, and after try to compare based on the scores and results they receive and be able to analyze if it's right or if it's wrong. I cannot tell one team is right or wrong. It depends on what, how they use their times. But in general, we have a lot of goals from set pieces. We know it about World Cup and in all competitions. Last time in Mundialito Clubs, not a lot because Braga was different, really different. But in general, we can say that we scored a lot of goals from set pieces. Also, a lot of goals with a low number of players, participants. That means one player, two players. And this is the most important things we have to take in consideration. Obviously, he's not here on the statistics, but the influence of the goalkeeper on the goal actions and on the creation of the superiorities.
Okay, thank you very much. Angelo, when you look at this slide and you look at the differences between the percentages, as a coach, what stands out for you that might change the way you prepare your country for the next competition?
Also, thank you. First of all, thank you very much for your work that you did. And it's a great work. For me, the biggest difference, if I see 10 years ago to Dubai, or maybe also Marseille or Rio de Janeiro, when I was analyzing all these World Cups, the biggest change is the open play goals. You know, we have here 168, 59%. And we see, for example, Portugal, they are doing this game. You know, they play with the two Martin brothers. They try to win the 1-1. And also, like the Brazilians, they love to do this. And we see they won the World Championship. And I think if you want to improve your team or if you want to go to the top, you need players who have these capacities. So for me, already an objective for the next years, I have to work with my players in individual technical technical stuff, you know, try to do a 1-1, try to win the 1-1, and having capacity to play 1-1 offensively, but also defensively. And the second thing is, what Amareya says, still the set pieces and 0-1 pass goals is very important, and it will be also important in the future. So don't forget to train also these stuff. Yes.
Yes. And, you know, if I was playing against Switzerland, I would spend a lot of time training defending restarts, because you're the master at preparing free kicks from either corner kicks, throw-ins, like Russia. And
I
those
think number
two
one,
aspects.
Ross, number one is Russia with set pieces, 100%.
Yes.
And
okay.
Leonov impressed me years ago. It was like this, when he had a throw-in, it was like a goal, you know? And
yes.
Even now when I work in Russia with my team, we have Crash, we have Shishi in our team. So you can be sure every match you score 2-3 times by corner kicks.
But yes,
of 100%. Course, you know, you need players who have the capacity to see what is the positioning of the players, who see how is running his own teammates. And of course, you can train it also. But you need also players who have the capacity to do this.
And we'll talk about this later on. Right now, I want to bring in Coach Emiliano. Emiliano, when you look at the statistics on the screen, what for you is most important?
Secondo me, vedo i gol. I gol sono importanti. Ho fatto un confronto con altre competizioni e rispetto alle partite giocate, l'incidenza dei gol è del 11,19%, e che è superiore, per esempio, all'ultimo mondialito di club che è stato giocato in Russia due mesi fa, ed anche ad altre competizioni, per esempio l'ultima Euro Beach Soccer League. Questo vuol dire che due cose: o c'è stata più capacità da parte degli atleti di segnare, oppure le difese erano meno organizzate rispetto alle difese dei club. Io penso più che sia stato merito dei calciatori, della qualità dei calciatori che hanno trovato capacità di gol in modo più facile rispetto a quando giocano nei club. Questa è un po', diciamo, la percentuale che mi ha colpito. Ma anche il gol, il 70%, il gol dopo un passaggio. Vuol dire che la semplicità di questo gioco resta l'arma più produttiva. Ad esempio, un passaggio tra il portiere e l'attaccante, piuttosto che un uno contro uno. Cioè il giocatore prende la palla, supera l'avversario e cerca di fare gol. Questo è un po' l'idea che mi sono fatto.
Okay, so in a nutshell, what he's saying is very important to him is the attacking principles with 0 or 1 pass, being 70% of all goals are scored with 0 or 1 pass. And the ability, Angela was talking about going 1v1, we have to understand how we collect the data, how we collect the statistics. If a player receives the ball and the play slows down and he is individually in control of the outcome, we don't consider this being seven passes when he got the ball. When he controls the ball and develops the game, and he alone creates the goal, this is a goal scored with zero passes. And when Coach Emiliano's talking about the goalie directly throwing it up forward to Gori, and Gori does a bicycle kick goal, this is a one-pass attack. And for him, 70%, this is extremely high. My next topic is, I wanted to compare the statistics that Ramiro brought up last week compared to the statistics of the 2019 World Cup. And were these statistics comparable? Because it's very easy for us to take statistics and say that they're valuable, but we have to look at the occurrences. How many times does Ramiro do a bicycle kick in a game? Where does he take those bicycle kicks from? What is the success ratio of a bicycle kick? We'll talk later with Coach Emiliano about the goal percentage being almost 18% for Italy on bicycle kicks. This is incredible. When the second team, Paraguay, had I think it was 1.7% success rate. So we need to understand the statistics and then over time compare them. And what we've been doing at the technical study group since 2006 is comparing the statistics year after year. And the restart goals, I wrote back in 2007 that the three major changes would be quick attacks. We need to stop a team from scoring from one or two goals or one or two passes. The goalkeeping role will change, and the Russians changing 4-4 is going to change the game. So looking at these statistics now, comparing the two different competitions, Ramiro, what do you see that might stand out and explain why there's a difference between the two?
From general stats, we can see only one real difference, that is the free kicks. We can talk about not a big difference between average goal, one goal in a match, between 9 and 10 goals is not a big difference. But in free kicks, yes. I could not say why on free kicks they change a lot or they have this 10% difference in average. I really can't explain, because on free kicks, is the ability of the and the capable of the keepers and of the forwards. It could change a little bit between one team and another one. It's real that on World Cup, the teams and the preparations are much better, I think. The clubs' competitions is different. Like in soccer, we have the different situations. Beach soccer, we invest more time, and spend more time on the preparation of national teams. We are our stars, other national teams. The clubs here is more. Except the Russian situation with Angelo in Russian league, they have more time to train. The other countries train less. They prepare the competitions less. And Mundialito clubs is a competition that they really prepare a few days. Then the players and the teams are not ready to buy nothing new. But the World Cup, yes. Then probably the concentration of the players and the mentality of the players in this kind of competition, like a World Cup, is a little bit higher. This is the main reason from my point of view.
Okay, Angelo, looking at this comparison of the two. Oh,
what I want to say, also, first of all, you know, statistics are important. What I think what interests our public or the coaches is how these statistics can help me to improve my team, you know. And I think it's important that to say to our public that the first, or to the coaches who watch now, that the first thing is I have to analyze my team and my players, and then I have to find a good way how I can improve my team by using these statistics, you know. And as you say, set piece is important, so I have to train it. The second thing is one touch, two touch goals, throw outs from the goalkeeper. Can I do this with my team? Yes, so I train it and I can improve fast. But for me, for example, When I studied this statistics, or if I watch the games of the big teams, when I see Portugal, they are winning now all the competitions. We have also the Portuguese team, who is very strong at the Mundialito. So I follow these things and I will improve my team by adapting a little bit all of these important things, you know. And this is important. And when I go back, as Ramiro said, in Tahiti, when I was starting with Tahiti, I was thinking, what can I do? How can I improve my team? And what? How is the best solution to improve in a fast way? So we had with Toro here a goalkeeper who was really strong with the foot. Mm-hmm. And I thought, okay, let's try to create a numeric superation. Advantage to the other team. And then we started to play with the goalkeeper. And you know, it was a good way for Tahiti. And I think also the coaches, they have to think, they have to analyze their team. And then they have to analyze in which way I can improve the team. And then, of course, the statistic helps.
Angelo, thank you so much for that. Because I remember in 2015 in Portugal, Guga, myself, and Ramiro, we went to watch all the countries training before the competition. And when we went to watch Tahiti, when you just said, if a team has the capacity, then I can implement the system and the styles that I want to play. I watched Tahiti. They went from the goalie to the right defender, diagonal pass, one touch passes to finish with four passes and a bicycle kick. And they did this over and over and over. The ball did not touch the sand. Well, if you have this technical capacity, then you can implement whatever you want. But when I was in China for 5 years and I tried to do this same warm-up, the ball would hit the ground because we were lacking the technical ability. And so my question to Emiliano is, when we look at statistics, if we look at the blocked shot statistic, the next slide, when you see this statistic of blocked shots, what do you see, Coach Emiliano, when you see the video or the screen of a blocked shot?
Puoi tradurre, per favore, grazie, Ross.
Okay, se guardi la pellicola dei tiri in porta che i difensori fermano, come fa l'importanza di guardare su questo fatto della partita, che il Giappone e il Senegal hanno 41 fermate di non portiere, di giocatori, ma c'è Portogallo che c'ha solo 17.
Questo dipende, allora, innanzitutto noi cerchiamo di allenare i nostri difensori a bloccare le azioni avversarie sempre, anche sulla cilena, che sembra una cosa oggi difficile, perché con il regolamento attuale diciamo che è favorito l'attaccante rispetto al difensore. Però noi cerchiamo di allenare anche la fase difensiva, il block shot sulla cilena. Il Giappone perché? Dipende anche dalla fisicità dei difensori. È chiaro che la fisicità dei difensori del Giappone è superiore alla fisicità dei difensori di altre squadre. E quindi okay, hanno più facilità e anche la capacità stessa di difendere dei difensori. Però tornando al discorso di prima, delle statistiche, se mi permetti, sono d'accordo sia con Ramiro che con Angelo. Sono statistiche che sono difficilmente comparabili, perché una nazionale rispetto al club che ha preparato il mondialito ha avuto più tempo per preparare, diciamo, questa competizione, il mondiale. E quindi questo ha comportato una fluidità di gioco e una maggior capacità di fare gol, mentre i club hanno avuto pochi giorni. E poi sono d'accordo con Angelo che dice che le statistiche importanti sono quelle che io utilizzo per migliorare la mia squadra. Il resto, diciamo che lasciano il tempo che trovano, nel senso che sono statistiche da analizzare dopo una competizione. Ma prima di una competizione io utilizzo le statistiche che possono migliorare la mia squadra. Esempio poi sarà i falli fatti oppure i falli subiti, il gol sul tiro libero. Queste sono le statistiche che utilizziamo, penso, noi allenatori.
Okay, so basically he's talking about, he was agreeing with with Angelo that you need to look at the statistics based on your team, how other teams are playing, and how you can use them to help your specific team. Ramiro was talking about the percentages of goals and the time that each club, this is what Coach Emiliano was saying, that the time that was used by the national teams was longer than what the club teams were having. So that's why the results were skewed one way or the other. In regard to the block shots, he was talking about some countries, depending on their physicality, like Japan with Ozu being tall and Senegal blocking shots and Switzerland. But the block shots are not only in size to try and block like the Iranian defenders blocking a bicycle kick, but it is blocking every shot. And the criteria we used in the TSG for blocking shots was similar to an own goal. If the ball was going away from the goal and someone blocked it, this is not a blocked shot. But if the shot was going towards goal and it had an opportunity to score, then the block became accredited to that team. And in looking at these statistics, Ramiro, when you look at a country like Japan and Senegal, Switzerland, Italy, and Brazil, five of the top countries in the world at the top of this slide, what do you see in the validity of a blocked shot statistic?
It's not a doubt that I am an offensive player. I have offensive mentality, but I really understand that, as Angelo said before, our next step on development of the players, on improvement of the players, is the defensive aspect. And this thing, this concept, the blocked shots, as you said, is not only the bicycle kicks, it's everything. It's any kind of defenses the defenders can do to save the keeper to have an action. Then it's amazing the possibilities that obviously Japan and African teams, why? Because of the physical condition. Obviously, also, please play 56 minutes, you know it, 36 minutes in each game. And he's physically is amazing. He's able and capable to defense a lot of space like the African teams. And they have a lot of advantages, obviously. But we need to increase the capacity of each of our players to defense the offensive situations of opponents. We have two kind of situations we have to take in consideration. The individual actions, like Angelo said, one against one, like against Twins Martins and like this kind of players that are able to dribble you one against one. You must be able to remain and save and block this kind of attacks. This is one. And the second one is the superiority situations created by the keeper that start and begin the attack. And you must be able to defense one against one in equal situations and inferiority situations. This is the two aspects we have to take in consideration on that. For sure, if you are not able to have a good defense, it's very difficult to go ahead on the competitions. But I'm going to say something more about Russia and Portugal. They they are on the low level because they give the opponents less times to attack. They don't give the opponents a lot of chances to attack because they manage the ball more time than the others. Then it's normal the others shoot less time on them. Then they will do less block. It's not means that they are not going at doing a good job. We have to analyze also their stats, like Angelo said before.
Okay. Thank you. So, Angelo, I think Amorelli just took your answer, but I was going to ask you, looking at Russia and Portugal, how can they be at the bottom? Explain this to the coaches that maybe don't understand statistics the same way some of us look at statistics. How can they be at the bottom of this slide, but yet be some of the best teams in the world?
Amorelli told it to us perfectly. I tell you, Ross, for me, this statistic is very important and very interesting. Portugal, with only 17 blocked shots, this means they anticipate all the actions before having danger. So when they have defense situation, they don't have the ball. They are so quick thinking and quick action that they don't give the opponent the opportunity to shoot or to have an action. And this is important. And this is for Portugal and for Russia. They have intelligent players who analyze in all seconds the game perfectly, and they are fast thinking, and they are anticipating the opponent to shoot or to have an opportunity to shoot or to have an opportunity to play on the goal. On the other hand, we have with Japan, and also this was Amareya perfectly saying, we have with Japan a player like Ozu, for example, that he also understands how to block. And in these teams, I think they keep the ball out of zone one. They keep the ball in zone two. So the opponent has maybe the chance to make a bicycle or to shoot from far away. And there the players, they can block the ball easily. So
yes.
You have to be on this side of this statistic or on the first side, but not in the middle.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. And I know that when we look at statistics, many people, number one, they don't understand the statistic, but number two, are scared of things that we don't know about, and then they shy away from it. And we'll talk about that later. But right now I want to talk about probably the most exciting part of the beach soccer world, and that's la rovesciata, la chilena, the bicycle kick. And when we look at statistics, and you look at the fact that Italy scored 8 goals in 45 attempts, this is 18% success. It's crazy. The second team, Paraguay, with 1 goal in 55 attempts, that's 2%. Does this in any way, Coach Emiliano, does this slide help you or hurt you in the chances of winning a World Cup?
Se questo grafico mi aiuta?
Sì, ti aiuta?
O ti fa male?
Yeah,
a te ti aiuta male. Sicuro.
Diciamo che sono molto contento, nel senso che dimostra la capacità che hanno i nostri calciatori di giocare questo tipo di giocata. Chiaramente quello che un po' mi sembra strano, sono il Brasile con solo 12 attacchi, mi sembra veramente strano. Dovrebbe, per come ricordiamo noi il Brasile, dovrebbe essere tra le prime squadre per capacità di attacco con la cilena, con palla alta. E anche il Paraguay, sinceramente, avendo anche visto le partite del Paraguay, non ho avuto la percezione che giocassero così tanto palla alta. Però dell'Italia sicuramente non avevo dubbi, perché ripeto, per le capacità che hanno i nostri calciatori non è assolutamente una sorpresa. Il fatto, okay, che noi siamo nettamente primi per gol con la palla alta, questo dimostra appunto le parole che ho detto. Abbiamo tra i migliori attaccanti che con capacità di giocare questo tipo di giocata.
So when he's talking about it's a skill that he's very proud of. He's very happy with the ability that the Italians technically have to not only attempt the overhead kick but be successful in it. He was also looking at the statistic and saying, how can Brazil, a country that basically invented this, be at the bottom of this slide? This is an interesting statistic. But if we watch the development of the Brazilian game, Ramiro, the one-on-one skills is what they are beginning to do. And that is changing the game, because we watch Portugal win the World Cup 2 times in the last 3 based on players' ability to go 1v1 on the sand and not needing to go to a bicycle kick, but they can do it if they want to. Ramiro.
Yes, sure. This is a great point. This question is amazing. And I think here we analyze it a lot, you and me, but Angelo and Emiliano are amazing. I don't want to talk a lot about that, but they don't understand how good they are. Then the thing is, from my point of view, several aspects. One, Brazil is completely different and it's cultural also. The bicycle kick come from them, yes, okay. They discover the sport and then they try to. But the capacities of the Brazilians, as we commented before, is like Portuguese's. They don't need to use the bicycle kick because they have the capacity to turn, to dribble, to run away, to create the spaces. Without that, then they are more sure that they can score in a high average if they shoot on from the floor than from bicycle kick. And except Rodrigo, who is amazing, obviously, and has a high average and percentage of successful, the others don't try, but they are able. They are capable, obviously. This is one thing. The other thing is, from Italian aspect, no, Italia was amazing because they did a great cultural job. Italian mentality is amazing on team spirit. And they choose the best, obviously, the best two top scorers in the world, like we saw in the World Cup. The average of successful of the Italian national team is because only the forwards most of the times try to do the bicycle kiss. And then the other countries try, we talked before about that, Angelo also talked, we have to adapt the statistics to our players and to our team. I cannot let the players to do any bicycle kick from anywhere. No, Italia choose the right moment and the right space and the right players to do the bicycle kick. And then they receive and they score more goals. Obviously, one point that is against Angelo is that on their tactic, they use odd on defense and they have a lot of successful because I love it. But they, I love him. But he didn't play on forward. Then they a little bit less level on bicycle kicks on offensive aspect, but they control the game. They play other game. Then from my point of view, bicycle kicks are okay, but it's important to have a good percentage of successful to do it. And this is the question of the coaches, and Emiliano did amazing, and also Angelo are on this amazing. We have to learn on these aspects.
Yes. So, Angelo, we're going to talk later about decisions coaches make at crucial times.
One second. Can I tell you something? Ross, second. I should clone Noel Ox. Then we have no problem. He's in defense and in offense. The other thing, what I want to say, this statistic can also hurt to us and to Italy, you know? If somebody knows that we have players who like to make, like Stankovic or Hodel, to make bicycle, then the opponent, they know that we do this. And you know, sometimes you win these matches with this strength, but you have, if you have important matches, maybe your opponent will close the situation that you can make bicycle, and then you will have a problem.
Thank you. My question to you, Angelo, is this. We talk about the primary action in a situation. So just stay with my thought. The goalie throws the ball. Stankovic controls it, lifts it, does a bicycle. This is the primary action. But the result of the primary action could be a goal. It could be he misses the net and it's a loss of possession. It could be a shot on goal and a save and a rebound. It could be a foul and a restart by free kick. It could be a save and a corner kick or a block shot and a throw-in. So when you look at these statistics of attempts of a bicycle or attempts of an attempt on goal, the secondary action, knowing the statistics, it's well worth me taking the shot and taking it early. Can you look at this graph in a different view now, not only in the initial action and the validity of the bicycle kick, but the secondary result of this action?
Yes, you're right. It's not always the best option to do a bicycle kick. That's clear, because of course, as we will see later on the video, that it can happen also the other things. But it's important, you know. You have a philosophy, and you have a sport. And for us, the philosophy is also important to play spectacular. You know, to play high and to play in the air. So for us, it's clear that we will not stop to try to play in this manner. And with players like Hodel, like with Ott Stankovic, who is the king of bicycles, we will try also in the future to play this style.
Fantastic. So going back to what Coach Emiliano was talking about before, he was talking about taking his forwards and putting them in situations that they could be more successful. Now, the next slide that we're going to be seeing is goals with two or more passes. So when we talk about you must score with zero and one pass because the success is 70%, you have better chance of scoring on restarts. When we look at statistics of teams qualifying and teams not qualifying, goals with two or more passes, the picture is very clear. If you want to win and qualify for the knockout, past the knockout phase, look at the statistics. You must have the technical ability to score with two or more passes. Ramiro, have a look and let me know what your feelings are.
No, this is a great, an amazing, for me, this is an amazing slide because it explains what we want to show, what all of us want to show. Statistics are important, but you need to learn and understand that because it's opposite. Most average of goals coming from zero and one passes. But if you are not able to score for with more than two passes, you will not qualify. It's amazing, yes. Because you have to understand the messages. The messages is, if you study the sport and Ross, you did it from the beginning, then you know that, and Angelo also stay here from the beginning of the sport, then the beginning is directly pass from the keeper to the forward and finish. And the sport is growing and growing and growing and improving. And right now, as statistics show you, you need to be able to connect between several players. You must be able to do it. If you are not able to do it, you will never have successful on a big competition. Obviously, most of the goals for the moment are arriving from only one pass, but the capacity of the players must be able to do several contacts and relationships between the defenders, the forwards, them. This is very, very, very crazy statistic, this one, but it's amazing.
Yes.
Okay.
Ross,
Angelo.
Ross, the yes. key word is possession of ball, you know.
Okay.
Two or more passes means do you have possession of ball. And this means not only you score, it means also you can avoid getting goals. You have the ball, you know. And this is very important. And we have with Portugal and we have with Brazil two teams and also with Russia who can do this. They are able to have possession of ball and they are able to score like this. And because of this, they are at the top of the world.
So my question to you, Angelo, is this. Looking at this slide, Tahiti did not qualify. But as we know, their first game against Italy was a colossal nightmare. They allowed way too many goals in the third period that took them out because they won their next two games and they did not qualify. But statistically, they are able to play a high level quality of game. And looking at this graph, tell me the future of soccer. We're going to be talking later, but based on statistics, do you think I can qualify with a country with only playing direct and only my whole attack is based on zero and one passes?
To qualify the group stage, also to pass the group stage in the World Cup?
Yes.
I think very difficult, very difficult. You know, only to throw away the ball, this is pass, you know, and the defenders, they are so strong and they anticipate. This is difficult. But of course, if you have a good concept, I remember Senegal in Ravenna, when we played against them, we thought it will be an easy game. But they had one target player in front and they throw all balls on his head, you know, and he scored. And at the end it was 7-7 and we had to go to penalties. I think it's possible, but I think to be successful in the World Cup, you need to have possession of ball.
Okay. And going one step further, I know, Ramiro, you're coaching in China right now. When I was there, knowing the capacity of my players, if I want immediate success, I have to play direct. I have to get into the first zone without multiple passes because I would lose the ball if we tried too many passes. But if I'm looking at the future, I must develop the team so that they have the capacity to play a game that includes goals with multiple passes. So Coach Emiliano, when you look at this video or this slide, and you look at the second slide with the goals scored in the knockout phase of teams advancing compared to teams that don't advance, more than double. What do you see, Coach Emiliano?
In questo grafico vedo che c'è una grossa differenza tra le squadre che hanno superato il girone rispetto a quelle che non le hanno superate nella capacità di, secondo me, di gestione della palla. Perché quando tu riesci a fare gol dopo due o tre passaggi, vuol dire che hai una capacità di gestione della palla differente. E non per questo il grafico precedente non mi ha stupito per niente, perché erano in prima posizione, nelle prime posizioni tutte quelle squadre che hanno nel proprio gioco una capacità di gestione della palla differente, come il Brasile, il Portogallo, la stessa Russia, seppure con una modalità di gioco differente. E questo grafico qui è la diretta conseguenza del grafico precedente che abbiamo visto, nel senso che c'è una grossa differenza tra le squadre nella gestione della palla, in determinati momenti della partita, nella capacità di passaggio tra le squadre che hanno superato il girone e quelle che non l'hanno superato.
Okay, so Coach Emiliano is saying that the graph is very simple to understand. Teams that qualify are able to score goals with multiple passes compared to teams that cannot. And spending time on these technical skills will obviously, according to the statistics, show that you can move on to the next level. So my next questions, there's so many ways of penetrating the box. And we watched Italy, Coach Emiliano, score so many goals on zero and one pass goals, even though they have the capacity to play multiple passes to create goals, but they are a very direct team in the past World Cup in 2019. And we know that statistically, goals scored inside the first zone, inside 9 meters, is very, very high. So can you give me your coaching philosophy and your training to create a situation of the ball getting inside of the box?
Guarda, anche questo grafico rispecchia, diciamo, la capacità, secondo me, di gestione della palla dei team. A parte il Brasile, che ha una capacità di gestione differente, riesce a giocare palla fino nell'area avversaria senza difficoltà per le qualità appunto individuali dei propri giocatori. E la Russia, che attraverso la particolarità di gioco che ha, riesce a portare palla all'interno dei 9 metri. Lo stesso Portogallo, che sulla falsa riga del Brasile. Mi sembra che anche questo grafico sia molto chiaro, cioè rappresenta la capacità, la stessa Svizzera, rappresenta la capacità delle squadre nella gestione della palla, nella capacità di sviluppare un certo tipo di gioco. L'unica, okay, diciamo, so, è lo stesso Tahiti. L'unica un po' così che, diciamo, in questo grafico è il Senegal, che ho l'impressione che si trovi in questa classifica attraverso un gioco differente. Ho visto un Senegal che giocava un beach soccer molto più semplice, se mi permettete la parola, rispetto ad altre squadre. Molte volte era il portiere che lanciava direttamente la palla sull'attaccante, la teneva già nei 9 metri e aspettava i compagni a supporto per andare a fare gol. Per il resto, diciamo, questo grafico rispecchia le qualità e la capacità di giocare delle nazionali, delle migliori nazionali del mondiale.
So, looking at this graph, there are two different pictures. One is a team like Brazil, who can get into the 9 meter box by multiple passing sequences, and their technical ability, countries like Brazil, Italy, Russia, and Portugal, have the ability to walk the ball with confidence into the 9 meter area and look for that secondary and third pass to the back post for an easy goal to score. Comparing that to a country like Senegal, and no disrespect to Senegal, but they're a direct team. The goalie will throw the ball directly, like Angelo said, to their people, and he will try and head it. And their goals scored or inside the 9 meter are differently created than Brazil, Italy, Russia, and Portugal, and Tahiti. So, Amarelli, when you look at this video, and I know we talked about this a lot on how countries play, to qualify to get to the World Cup, to create these types of goals in the 9 meter area, remember, this also includes free kicks from the penalty spot. This includes rebound shots in the 9 meter area. It includes any goal that's scored inside the zone one. Ramiro.
Well, here, I think Senegal is the only one who is different, I know, on the style. But I really love also when we watch the games in during the World Cup, we talk about that. How impressive is Senegal? And Angelo talked about that also before. We have to adapt our style to base it on the capacities of the player. We cannot ask the players of Senegal to combine and be able to keep the ball on the eye because they have no experience, they have no knowledge, they have no time practice also. They have no experiences. They have no the chance to play and train matches with this kind of style. Then they go to the World Cup with a few trainings and they without experience and play against other teams. But it's amazing. I really love it to play against this kind of teams because they are physically strong, high level, obviously, and they are able to arrive in the area in one pass. It's hurt you. If you do any mistake, they will punish you. Then ask you and require you high concentrate level. The other teams, I think all of them are amazing. Italy, Russia, Portugal, Tahiti, Japan, and Switzerland. They are the teams who develop the sport, and they are the teams who are showing how to arrive and manage the ball and be able to arrive to the final spaces. The other ones are on the way, but they have some mistakes. They are not ready yet. Then they probably have small things, small details, because at the end, everybody knows beach soccer is only a simple detail, make you win or lose. But this is the level of the teams. Obviously, Brazil, everybody, all of us know the quality of the players and the capacities of the players. They are able to run with the ball, stop, change directions, make passes, exchange the ball, shoot whatever they want. After all the aspects influence on the final result, on the final score. But the capacities of the individual capacities of the player are that they can do it. Then this is clear. This is light. It's very clear also.
Angelo. Please Ross, explain. Yes, explain.
You surprised me with this statistic because we scored only 8. But I know why. You know, we have 5 strikers on the field with Elliot, Ott, Borer, Stankovic, and Hodel. We have 5 strikers on the field and we score only 8. But maybe because when Elliot's coming out until I don't know where. To the midfield, and then he plays a good pass to Borro and Ott, and they can shoot directly. So we have more goals from outside the box at the moment than inside of the box.
Exactly, because Ott keeps hitting those 18-meter volleys. Listen, Angelo, looking at the slide that has 0 passes to score, Brazil. Yes. Why? How can Brazil, a country that's known for multiple passes. I remember one of the World Cups, they passed 27 passes. Honestly, it was against Italy in the World Cup final. 27 passes before they scored a goal. But now,
Ross,
they're
includes
the number
this
one
also
team.
Set pieces, includes this penalty and free kicks?
Yes, sir.
Yes, so you
so
have
explain,
the solution.
Explain the slide, please.
We have players, Brazil and Italy. They are individually so strong and they will be fouled a lot. Also, if we have Gori, he's impressive. You know, he is doing a perfect bicycle kick. So the most defenders are blocking badly. They're doing a foul and then it's a goal. And the same is with Brazil. We have the 1-1 maybe and they are fouled. You know, they are not good defended. It will be a foul and then they can shoot by set pieces and score a lot. Am I right, Ross?
100%, my friend.
Thank you.
So what's important is we have to understand how statistics are collected and what the statistics actually mean. Because zero passes includes penalty shots, every free kick, rebound, any stolen ball by the forward putting pressure. We'll see later, Ramaciotti steals the ball from the Russian defender and scores. Mm-hmm. This is an open play goal, zero passes inside the box.
Absolutely.
So we have to understand the statistics.
Absolutely. And you know, if you have a player like Stankovic, every foul is a goal.
Yeah, 100%. Your game against Paraguay with Stankovic in overtime gets fouled, free kick, goal. Gets fouled, free kick, penalty shot, goal.
Absolutely.
Why? His percentage of goals on restarts is incredible. When I used to think of Majer from 18 meters, it's a goal. I'm going to tell you a short story. Amarelli, he doesn't shoot for power from the center spot, 18 meters. He does a left foot side bouncing ball 15 feet from the goalie. How do I know? I have video after video after video, and my Chinese team would watch him, and they would want to be like Amarelli. They don't kick it hard.
Ross, Amarelli was not a player. He was an artist.
Okay. Very good.
He was an artist.
Okay, so let's move on. Ramiro, next question is for you.
Oh.
If we know that restarts are so important, and coaches should, I'm hoping by this point, after all the technical studies that we've done, look at the statistics and say it's important. I know players don't want to work on restarts. I know this. But looking at the statistics, how much time do you actually spend with your team in training on restarts? Ramiro.
I think players don't like, but the players like to win. The players love to win. Then usually on the training process, they don't like. But when the World Cup is there, when the qualifier is there, when the important match is there, the mind of the players change a lot. And they are available 100% for everything you ask to them because they want to win. Then it's a real statistic that you know that 40% of the goals come from set pieces. Then free kicks, any kind of attack, static attack from set pieces, you must be trained. How you work it, talking with the players most of the time, obviously, talking to the players, playing them, showing them the stats. I use the stats to show the players how important are and how important could be for us. And it will be a simple action. That means a set piece, a restart, it means 5 seconds action. It's a concentration action. You need to have the technique, obviously, the experience. Angelo talked before about that. Deja and Gori, these kind of players, they are magic. They are amazing because they are able to concentrate 5 seconds, and the quality and the capacity and the experience is amazing, obviously. I try to talk with the players, and I try to invest from any kind of team around 30% of the time on training set pieces. But you have a lot of ways to train that. Lot of ways to practice match situations, game situations, static, anything. You have a lot of chances to do it, but you need to invest time on that for sure.
For sure. So Angelo, I remember back in, when I was working with Joaquin Alonso and we were in Ravenna in Italy, and he presented me with a present after the group phase. And it was a memory stick with every restart from every country, from every position. And I looked at it and I said, this is so much work. And I know that you as a coach, Angelo, spend multiple hours with your team. Do you also spend it in the classroom with video analysis and have your players watch your opponent?
Yes, of course, yes. I think this makes part of the work of a coach. I do this with Crystal, and I do this with the national team. Of course, we have to analyze the opponent. And of course, we try also to analyze our game and to improve by video analysis. But it's not, you know, and Amarella told it, it's also difficult to do the work with set pieces on the field. Because if you have players like Stankovic, before training, he already sends you a message and says, today only matches. And when I go to Crystal, it's a crash sending me message, only matches today, you know, in the training. So you have
so to you find. Have the pressure, you have the pressure from the players.
Well, absolutely, but you have to find, and Amareya said it right, you have to find intelligent moments, make a bit, little bit game with the set pieces or work at the video, but you need to train it. That is important, of course.
Okay, thank you. Coach Emiliano, if you look at the video or the restart goal slide, are you happy with Italy's production in restart goals?
Can you translate?
Okay. Coach Emiliano, quando guardi la pellicola del rete sul restart, sei contento col risultato dell'Italia? Quando fai le pratiche, sei contento col risultato?
Rispetto a questo grafico, a questi sì. slide?
Sì.
Ok, rispetto a queste statistiche, sicuramente sui restart goals potevamo fare meglio. Obiettivamente qualcosa di più potevamo fare. Sono sorpreso, pensavo meglio. Però diciamo che proveremo a migliorarla questa statistica. Ecco.
Ok. He's saying that he's relatively happy with it. He was expecting to be higher in the standings according to the restart goals. But Mike, I want to just have a follow-up question with you, Angelo, with yes. Switzerland.
Yes.
I know when I scout and I look at teams' tendencies, and I did a coaching course in Iran, and I used yes. Switzerland as an example. I said, because they love to play man-to-man in Iran. And I showed them, I said, if you play man-to-man and you leave Stankovic from the left side with the left foot volley, I know what he's going to do. They're going to set a simple pick and roll, and Stankovic is going to come to 10 meters and do a side volley, and it's going to be a goal. It is so obvious.
Absolutely.
So for you, what restart is your favorite restart for your country? If you wanted to say, I want to have a throw in, a corner kick, a free kick from outside, let's say 18 meter free kick, which one would you pick?
You know, also first of all, when we have Stankovic in a team, I love to have fouls, you know, this is of course, but it's the same, like I said before, it's an individual thing. You have to analyze your team, your players, and then you have to find the solution for corner kicks. You have to, the best solution, you know, you have to find the best solution with throw-ins, and you have to find the best solution for the restart of the game by the start of the game. So I check my team, I analyze my team, I analyze my players, and then I try to convince my players to play the best option. So if the corner kick is from the left side, of course, we try to search Stankovic. If the corner kick is from the right side, of course, we try to find a solution that Hodl can make a bicycle kick. In the restart, we have a player like Borr who has a very strong hit. So we try to find a solution that he can kick on the goal. So the question is analyzing your team, analyzing your players, and then to find the best options to and create good and interesting options to score. And the second thing is, I want to say, don't try to do 6-7 options. Try to make one or two things, but do it good.
They say keep it simple, right?
Absolutely.
Okay, so I'm going to move on. And I want to do, before we get to the videos, I want to say a real simple thing. I don't want anybody to get offended. I don't want anybody to get upset. We only want to learn from looking at these videos, because I've made a million mistakes as a coach and as a player, and I just want to learn and I want to go on to the next step. So the next topic that I'm going to have is time management. And if we think about sports, baseball, basketball, volleyball, American football, any sport, the coach dictates what happens in the most crucial parts of the game. So if we go to the video, and we've got Italy versus Switzerland, and we're going to watch the video a few times before we start to talk. because my first question is going to be to Angelo, and it's going to be, was this a rehearsed set play that you practiced, that you were comfortable with? Would you do it again? And I know that when we look at, you know, the result isn't what you wanted, Angelo, but if you were going to do it again, is this something that your team was prepared for at this point in the game? Because when we look at the video, the goal by Zurlo is an absolutely cracker. The percentage of this goal with the goalie throwing it diagonally and hitting a right-footed volley over your right shoulder is crazy hard. When we talk about percentages of goals being scored, to do this, you could do this 10 times. I don't think you'd get the same result. Only Amorelli can score from the corner flag. And I know Coach Emiliano was talking about this yesterday, that normally you say this type of goal is low percentage, let it go. But Amorelli would score from the corner flag on a left foot volley from a goalie throw from the left side regularly. He did it to me in Spain, in Portugal, when Spain was playing against China. He did it in the World Cup, one of the best goals in the world. So in looking at this sequence, going back to my questions, Angelo, would you do it again? Is it something you practiced? Are you comfortable with the option that you were left with looking at the video?
Ross, I couldn't see the video. It was broke.
No.
Ross, first of all, I think my players, they did everything right. Elliot, he is a fantastic goalkeeper with a fantastic feet. He comes out and we have 3 or 4 seconds on the clock. So for me, if I could turn back the time, of course, I would say maybe wait 1 second longer. But, you know, I don't watch on the clock on this moment. I knew we have 2 or 3 seconds more. And I told him, or I was thinking, please shoot. And we see the ball is maybe 20 centimeters from the post passing. We could also win this match if the ball goes in. And then what we have then is the fantastic of sports, of beach soccer. We have, this is the fantastic action of a magnificent player, and he made a fantastic goal. So I went home. Of course, I was not very satisfied because we lost, but I was satisfied how our team played this World Cup. And in this game, we don't lost about this situation. We lost the game because we missed so many goals before.
Okay, so Angelo, I'm going to do a follow-up question to you. I'm going to be the devil's advocate. I'm just going to ask you a question.
Yes.
Your goalie, is he a better forward than Ott?
He has a fantastic shoot, Elliot, yes.
Okay, but...
It was a decision, you know. He could also pass to Ott. But then maybe the clock... Imagine he passes to Ott. Ott touches one time the ball, he shoots, and the time is over. Everybody say, Elliot, are you crazy? Why you don't shoot directly?
Okay. So the question then is time. Yeah, it's time management. 7 seconds in beach soccer is an eternity. Because if you look at this video through a different perspective now and be open to this, the time that's allowed your goalie, because he was playing with the ball, he could have given it to Stankovic. Stankovic could have laid it off to Ott. Or you could have gone directly to Ott. Ott scored 2 unbelievable volleys from that same position. That's another look. And it's another option. But like you said, it happens very fast. And the time on the clock and the percentage, the chance of this goal against you happening again is so low. And the chance of you scoring was 1 foot away. So my question to Ramiro right now, when you look at this video, what do you see as a potential way of stopping this goal, defending this goal? I look at Mo on the shot. Mo is standing at center. Instead of maybe going back and becoming a defender, which he is.
Yes. Really, I think that this kind of the tiles coming from the thing Angelo talked before, the decision of the player. And one important thing from my point of view also is the confidence of the players and the importance of the coaches on increase the self-confidence of the players. And I think on that also Angelo is very good. The message to the players about the situation, the contents, and after you have to choose. If you choose wrong, we will lose the ball. If you choose right and do it right, we can score. Yeah. Then, come on, let's go. What I need to do as coach, prepare my team to this kind of situations as much time as I can. Then I think, I'm sure, this situation, Swiss train a lot. And I'm sure this situation with Elliot playing with the ball on the eye and capable to pass or to shoot or to shoot on Bore, who is on second post also. I'm sure if I have the keeper, Elliot, if I have Elliot, I will give always the ball for him for sure. And try to, don't worry. I support you for sure 100%. Because his average successful is very high. Unluckily for them, Angelo is right. Unluckily for them, this time they miss and they lost and they go away. But not only for this time. Anyway, okay. on this aspect, yeah. I think on beach soccer, the collective training process for beach soccer players has not reached this level of control and mastery at the moment. Then our players train individually a lot of times, collective group team sometimes, but we didn't arrive yet to that situation in which the players are able to manage the situations, the contest, like in other sports, like we told before, baseball, basketball, volleyball, American soccer. This is, for the moment, our players, the culture of beach soccer for the moment, are not ready for that, the process, from my point of view.
Okay, Coach Emiliano, when you watch this video, obviously you're ecstatic, you're very happy, but are you happy with the defensive structure as Switzerland was preparing to final 5-6 seconds of the attack?
Allora, innanzitutto, questa sembra una giocata così affrettata, ma questa qui è una giocata che personalmente è, sia Ramiro che Angelo, però questa è una transizione da difensiva in offensiva. Quindi velocemente cerco di giocare la palla in avanti, cercando di far correre la squadra avversaria verso la loro porta dopo un'azione di attacco. Quindi questa giocata non è una giocata casuale. È chiaro che il fatto che sia accaduta a un secondo praticamente dalla fine ha un attimo esaltato questo tipo di giocata, ma è una giocata che noi proviamo tantissimo, specialmente contro le squadre che utilizzano in modo, diciamo, integrale questo modulo dell'1-2-2. E chiaramente Elliot, secondo me, fa quello che deve fare. Porta palla fuori, Zurlo parte un pizzico dopo e quindi cerca di calciare la porta, e non è fortunato, perché la palla poteva finire in porta e finiva la partita. Noi facciamo questo qui, ci fermiamo alla bandierina con Zurlo, sulla bandierina di metà campo, per cercare di forzare la giocata al portiere. Elliot fa una scelta, calcia in porta e noi di conseguenza andiamo a giocare la transizione.
I'm sure that
c'è la paura di Demestre nell'assist e c'è la grandissima paura di Giulio nella girata.
I'm sure
però,
that
ripeto, se voi vedete se voi vedete anche altre partite, non è la prima volta che facciamo una giocata del genere. Giusto. Se vedete anche la partita con la Russia, anche se è una partita particolare, tante volte abbiamo provato questa imbucata.
That point is what I want to say, Emiliano, that if Angelo can choose a team to train, he will choose you. Because Italia is the best team, on counter-attack style. Then for Angelo, it's amazing to train, because Angelo is an offensive coach. Swiss is an offensive team. Then he will love to train against that kind of teams. And Angelo told before about that. They try the attack. They have a mistake because they shoot out and not score. Ramiro,
ma questa è la nostra scuola.
Giusto, no, sto non parlando.
Io non posso pretendere dall'Italia che fa la stessa giocata di qualità che fa la Svizzera piuttosto.
No,
perché tutti i giocatori sono differenti. La Svizzera, la Svizzera ha un triangolo basso con Elliott, Borer e Noel Ott, che poche squadre al mondo hanno quella qualità.
The capacities of the players are amazing. Del Mestre, Engori and Zurlo, they are the best from my point of view. Throwing the ball away, Del Mestre, it's amazing. He's able to put the ball where he wants. And the forwards, Gori and Zurlo, finishing on first toes like bicycle kicks, they are top in the world, obviously top scorer in the world. Then this is amazing situation, like Angelo told before. Crazy for Swiss, amazing, and amazing for Italy. Luckily, win Italy. Okay, yeah. Congratulations. Amazing for both. From my point of
view. Amarelli. Hold on one sec. So when we're talking about, we have more videos I want to watch too, and I don't have enough time to go through everyone. So I want to move on because the next game that I want to talk
about. I think the ball boy was Italian.
Yes, he gave the ball. I know this happened to me. Okay, so this next video we're going to watch is Russia against Brazil. And when we watch this video, you see the final seconds. And I freeze on the bicycle kick itself. It's 11 minutes, 59 seconds. So this would have counted. But the topic is time management. What you don't see on the video is this free kick was Russia possession. 22 meters from the goal on the left side of the field with 7 seconds on the clock. And instead of keeping possession of the ball, with Brazil putting all four players in Russia's box, Russia elected to shoot on goal. And instead of just keeping possession and running out the clock, they gave Brazil the opportunity to a chance at goal from a restart with one pass to a bicycle kick. And this is something that, Amarelli, you said you were going to talk to the coach from Russia. But I remember we were sitting there watching the game, Amarelli. And as soon as they did this, we said, what is he doing? And immediately the situation changed. If Brazil scores on the bicycle, this is a different result. It changes the World Cup completely. So, Ramiro, very quickly, because I've got some more stuff to get to, but how would you have handled this situation if you were the coach? Or did you think about this?
I think this question is in relation with the other one. And we talk about the management of the last seconds. On beach soccer, didn't arrive yet to that situation. But from my point of view, I would try to keep the ball for sure, shoot on lateral. But it's real also the thought about if I pass the ball and I lost the ball against Brazilians, I will lost then. Both options. For me, from my point of view, I try to save the ball. I will try not to give the chance to Brazil to shoot. I will try to keep the ball on my own. Because always, as Angelo said also, our mentality is to keep the possession of the ball. My mentality is to fight to score. But if I have the ball, I think I can be able to keep the ball for 20 seconds. I don't worry about other things. Give me the ball. And I don't care about coaches say, give me the ball. I will try to keep my ball myself. By myself, then it's difficult because the coaches have no the control 100% of the players, obviously, and it's decisions, quick decisions. But you have to work on it also, training situations about that.
And this is time management. So, Angelo, my question for you is the next video, and the next video is a sequence that Paraguay had just scored, and the game was tied at 4-4, and Ozu decides to take control of the game. So if we can go to the video of the Paraguay versus Japan game, you will see on a corner kick, Angelo, that Ozu, he's 25 meters from the ball with 5 seconds on the clock. He sprints to the corner kick and they execute a perfect back post header to win the game. But as far as the topic, time management, nobody else reacted, but Ozu knew how much time was on the clock. And he made the difference. And that's when we talk about individuals making the difference and the decisions. I'm sure they practiced this corner kick, Angelo, many times. But you can see the placement of the ball by Ozu. Is it more than 1 meter from the corner flag? I'll let you decide. Look at the angle. He was looking to shoot on goal. But when that option was gone, he went to secondary option. And we know the defender didn't do it properly, but just the intenuity, the ability of Ozu to dominate this, Angelo. What do you see?
Absolutely individual class of this player. And this is the same topic like Amareya said before. Decisions on the field. The top class players, they analyze quick and they react in a good way. And Ozu, with his experience, and they, of course, they trained this kind of corner kicks. And we know also that this number nine, he's very strong with the head. He's a big guy, one of the biggest guys in Japan. So, and the defenders of Paraguay, they are not so tall. So he find the best solution for this corner kick. And here we have a mistake and a lack of experience of Paraguay. This is the problem. Maybe if they defend the ball better, maybe, you know, this is lack of experience. And Japan was fantastic to score and to win this match by individual class. And of course, also team tactics, set pieces. Everything was perfect in this moment.
Perfect. Thank you, Angelo. Coach Emiliano, I want to look at the next video because when I scout a team and I look at a team prepare, I try to prepare my team. I look at...
Stop.
Hello?
Sorry. Rewind the video. Oggi, se possibile.
Oh, vuoi vedere...
Sì.
Vuoi vedere il gol del Giappone?
Sì.
Ok. Per favore, Laura.
Se è possibile.
Ok. Vuoi dire qualche cosa di questo gol? Dai.
A me, personalmente... Ferma. Stop. Personalmente, a me non piace l'atteggiamento, la classe di oggi e l'esperienza. Ok, abbiamo detto, grandissimo giocatore, grande giocata. L'atteggiamento complessivo della difesa del Paraguay. Il difensore è posizionato malissimo con il corpo e non vede la palla, ma ti dirò di più. Stop, se possibile. Il difensore centrale, quello che copre la zona centrale, ha un atteggiamento passivo. Sembra che in quel momento lui non entri in quell'azione e invece deve essere più attivo.
Ok, so
che è la giocata di Ozu, grande giocata, ma la favorita dall'atteggiamento della difesa del Paraguay in questo video.
Okay. So coach Emiliano is talking about the defensive positioning of Paraguay was not professional in this situation. They did not prepare themselves and basically this goal, coach, this goal eliminated Paraguay because they lost this game and they lost the next goal game by one goal. And it pretty much put them out of the World Cup. But you're correct. The positioning is wrong. But what my point was the time management. And there was only one player that realized it. Because if I was Paraguay, I would have gone and stood 2 meters from the ball and made the referee slow the game down and the clock would have run out. So I want to go to the next video. And this question is for Coach Emiliano. Emiliano, looking at the statistics, watching your team right now on the screen, statistics repeat themselves if you look at a quantity of shots. Do you think that if I'm a coach watching Gori shoot a free kick less than 18 meters from the right side, he will shoot to the goalie's left side and high? Would you agree with me?
Can you translate the response?
Okay. Se io guardo le pellicole della tua squadra, e guardo Gori sulla punizione diretta, quando la palla è alla destra, lui tira sempre il primo palo è alto. È giusto?
No.
Dalla destra.
Perché sono scelte che il calciatore fa al momento. Se vedi tante volte tanti gol che ha fatto Gabriele, lui chiude o sul primo palo, ma molte volte apre anche sul palo lontano. Dipende anche dalle caratteristiche del portiere avversario. Questi calciatori di questo livello studiano tutto. Noi cerchiamo di far vedere tutto, pregi e difetti delle squadre avversarie. Molte volte calciano anche raso terra, perché magari il portiere è più alto e fa fatica a cadere, a buttarsi a terra, okay. Magari è più bravo dalla cintola in su, quindi sono scelte che i calciatori fanno al momento e sinceramente
okay, so
è solamente un caso che...
So, coach is saying that, no, he doesn't only shoot to the near post and high. He looks at the situation, he looks at the goalie, he looks at strengths and weaknesses of the situation, and then he can even go to the back post. That's not a problem. So that's why statistically, if I only show you two shots from Gori from the right side, and they both go near post, this doesn't mean that this statistic is going to hold water later on. Because if I gave you 10 shots from Gori from the right side in a row and they all went to the near post, now the statistic has some valor. So it's very important we understand statistics, and listening to the coach, he sees him every day, he sees him in multiple situations. Now his opinion is much more important than me making an assumption that Gori only scores near post high from the right side on a left-footed shooter. So I want to go on to the next slide, and the slide is third period goals. Now, last week, Ramiro, Gilberto was talking about players having mental blocks. And just briefly, if you can you tell me what looking at this graph might be in regard to players having mental blocks and only wanting to train things that they're good at compared to things that their mind blocks them from? Ramiro.
Here, I think the key point is experience, players. You talk about that. Also, last seconds decision. Decision of the master in the last second, last 2 seconds. Get the ball quickly and pass to Zurlo. The decision of Zurlo after defensive situation, running away. It's missing 2 seconds. Then the important thing on the last period, from my point of view, is the experience and the decisions of the players. But regarding the statistics, is very close, I think. It means 5, 6, 7 goals is not a big difference. But important is what kind of players they have, what kind of players are these teams have. And most of them are have players who have a lot of experiences. The other option is the players who are not afraid to show. And in this slide, with stats of the World Cup, we saw in Paraguay a lot of chances to do a lot of things right. We talk about that, but they were unlucky during the classification phase, the first phase, the group phase, and they did a lot of things right. Unluckily, they began on the wrong way, losing a match. But after that, they show us a lot of aspects. Then, in these aspects, it's clear that the matches, most of them are solid on the third period. What factors influence? The physical condition, obviously. You have no quality, if you have no physical condition to be able to run, it's impossible to play. And the mentality. In this aspect, in the third period, for me, the key point is the most important players. You have to control the experienced players, the top quality players, because they will get the ball. Like in basketball, Michael Jordan, Kobe Bryant, this kind of LeBron, always the last second shoot. Who will do it? The best one, most of the times.
Okay. Well, we're getting close to the end. We're going to the future. Angelo, my question is for you. Based on all the data, all the statistics, looking at the past, knowing where we are now, in regard to the goalie's role in the team, Angelo, tell me what you see in the future of the game. In respect to the goalie, Angelo.
Yeah, the goalkeeper is absolutely a key point of the team. We see that the goalkeeper needs to play with the feet. But as we see the last goal with Del Mestre, the goalkeeper has also to analyze the situation. Maybe I have to make quick the game. I have to make slow the game. He needs to control the game. He needs to make the rhythm of the game. So the goalkeeper has absolutely a key point in the future. And don't care if you play 2-2 or 1-3-1 or how else, but the goalkeeper makes the rhythm. And if you want to be successful, you need a harmony between in all the team between goalkeeper and his players.
Thank you. That's fantastic. Coach Emiliano, nel futuro, how important is athleticism and physical power of the player?
Già negli ultimi anni c'è stata una grandissima evoluzione da parte degli atleti di beach soccer. Oggi quasi tutti gli atleti sono strutturati fisicamente, lavorano tanto sulla forza, sull'esplosività, sulla resistenza. Prima probabilmente qualche atleta top lo faceva prima, ma complessivamente c'era meno professionalizzazione. Oggi la parte atletica e fisica dell'atleta è diventata fondamentale.
Okay,
anche so, le squadre di maggior classe lavorano tantissimo sull'aspetto atletico.
Perfect. So Coach Emiliano is basically talking about the physicality of the game, the endurance have changed the sport, and that's the biggest part in the future that he sees will help teams go on to the next level. And I agree 100% with him. We've seen it develop over the years with countries playing 4-4. Ramiro, talk about the unexpected situations that we've witnessed. 47 degrees on the field, storms and wind. And Laura, if we can get the last two videos, please. The one-on-one situations that Portugal and Brazil show us. And then all of a sudden, what the weather situations can be. So the last two videos, where Portugal is going 1v1, Ramiro, and then also the weather conditions. And you can see the Italian government, all the individualities. So Ramiro, go ahead, talk about the unexpected situations that we might see in the future.
We don't know what we are going to build together with the sport. I expect that all of us will increase our level and be able to help the players to improve their level. Angelo and me talked at the beginning about that. The individual skills, the individual aspects with the ball and without the ball, then the management of the ball, the comprehension of the game, then you cannot give a book to the player and the book and understand the moments and the times and the rhythms. This is not he's not going to learn from a book. He's going to learn from experiences. Then we must be able to create training process better than now, longer than now. We need more competitions below national championships, grassroots programs. And in this aspect, I want to comment and to congratulate both of our guests, because Angelo made an amazing job in Swiss and Italian Federation with Emiliano also great a job during all these years about improvement of the individual skills of the players. This is one step. About the other aspects, you talked before about the weather and other aspects. We have to think about working our players across their capacities. That means it's not thinking only about I'm going to play in the best sand of the world with the best weather of the world. I don't know where I'm going to play in 6 months. I don't know how the weather will be. I don't know what the referees is going to do. Then you have to prepare your players in day-to-day under press situations. Then you have to create situations with controlling the time, controlling the weather, controlling the referees, controlling the number of defensive players, controlling the number of teammates. If you are able to prepare your players mentally on that aspect, you are creating better players, you are improving the capacities and the level of your players, and the players and the team will be more ready to control the unexpected situations.
Well, thank you so much. We're coming to the end of our 1 hour program with a laugh. The final statements I just want to make, and we can see the video here of the conditions in one of our games, which was you cannot prepare for these situations, but fear comes from unknown. We need to continue to educate. We need to remember that if we don't keep improving, if we don't have confidence to take information and go forward and give it to anybody that wants it, then we are not doing our job. I want to thank Beach Soccer Worldwide. This is a fantastic concept, and we have We've started something next week. I want to remind you, we're doing Beach Soccer Talk number 3. I can't wait. But I want to thank our guests. Ramiro, been a pleasure, always will be. Angelo, we go back a long way, and we will see you again. And Coach Emiliano,
ciao.
Buona fortuna, ci buona vediamo fortuna. Più vecchi. Okay.
Okay.
Everybody,
thank you.
Thank you so much. Appreciate
pleasure.
It.
All of thank you. You. Appreciate. Thank you very
grazie.
Much.
Grazie. Ciao. Ciao, ciao.
Ciao, ciao.
Ciao, ciao. Goodbye. Thank ciao, you, ciao. Ross.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Great job, Ross. Thank you very much.
Thank you, guys.